So in this example, we're going to prove the two annuity formulas. So let me first write down the formulas, remind you what they are. The first one is a constant annuity. And that's given by cash flow divided by discount rate times 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus r to the power of n. Okay, the next one is a growing annuity. That's given by C divided by R minus G times 1 minus 1 plus G divided by 1 minus R divided by 1 plus R to the power of N. All right, very good. So to begin with, let me prove what's called the sum of geometric series first. So what's a geometric series? A geometric series is a series of numbers that changes in value by a constant over time. So let's write it down to see. Okay, sum of the geometric series that are n terms includes, okay, let's start off with a. Let's call this a constant. The next term in the series is going to be a multiplied by x. Okay. The next one is going to be a times x squared and so on. And the last one in the series, well, since there are n of them, that's going to be a multiplied by x to the power n minus 1. Okay, and if you sum them all up, they're now n terms in the series. Okay, so let's multiply this line by x. We're going to get x times sn equals ax plus ax squared plus ax cubed and so on. Okay, plus ax to the power of n minus 1 plus ax to the power of n. Now, I'm writing the same series, but shifted by one position and all multiplied by x. All right, so let's deduct x times sn from the original one. So we're going to get 1 minus x times sn. And what does this give us? If you do sn minus x times sn, this term will cancel out with this term. This term will cancel out with this term, and so on. So we're going to be left with just two terms, okay? A and also a times x to the n, with a minus sign in front, of course. So we're going to get a minus a times x to the n, so we can write okay, the sum of a geometric series as a times 1 minus x to the n divided by 1 minus x. Let me change the symbol to be consistent. Okay, so you may have learned this in high school and so on. This is going to be the central ingredient that proves okay, the constant annuity and growing annuity. So first, let's write down okay, what does a series of constant annuity look like? Okay, a constant annuity looks like this. Okay, and the last term in the series, say, you know, at time n, you want to find the present value, you're going to do this calculation. Right? 1 plus r squared, 1 plus r cubed, sum them all up and so on. Okay, and this is the present value of annuity. Now, can we see the parallel? All right, so let me call A. Okay, let A equals this term. So here is our AX. So that implies X is equal to 1 divided by 1 plus R. So this looks like okay, SN, doesn't it? So we can apply the geometric sum formula that we have over here to our cash flow example down here. Okay, make a few substitutions. Remember, Sn equals a times y minus x to the n divided by 1 minus x. So what does that give us? A gives us c divided by 1 plus r. What about 1 minus x to the n? That gives us 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus r to the n. What about 1 minus x? This gives us 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus r. Right. So let's do an expansion of this term. 1 minus 1 divided by 1 plus r. That's essentially 1 plus r minus 1 divided by 1 plus r, right? So this gives us r divided by 1 plus r. Now, you see here, r divided by 1 plus r, but this is in the denominator, right? So this 1 plus r is going to cancel with this 1 plus r over here. You'll be left with this formula. Looks familiar? Well, that's the formula of present value of annuity. Now, if you can use this, then the next step is very much the same, the present value of a growing annuity. Well, what does that look like? A growing annuity looks like this, right? C divided by 1 plus r plus C times 1 plus g divided by 1 plus r squared plus C times 1 plus g squared divided by 1 plus r cubed, and so on. Okay, and the last term is going to be C times 1 plus g to the power of n minus 1 divided by 1 plus r to the power of n. You make a very similar substitution where you let a equal c divided by 1 plus r, and then you also let x equals, this time not 1 divided by 1 plus r, but it's going to be 1 plus g divided by 1 plus r. So I'll leave this for you to do. You can show that this sum is going to be c divided by r minus g times 1 minus, open parenthesis, 1 plus g divided by 1 plus r to the power of n. Okay, so if you want to apply this to a perpetuity instead, okay, so a perpetuity is where n tends to infinity. So for the earlier case of a constant annuity, c divided by r times 1 minus 1 plus r to the power of n. As n tends to infinity, this term goes to 0, right? Because 1 divided by something greater than 1, as you multiply them together, this number gets smaller and smaller. So in the limit, this approaches 0. So the perpetuity formula becomes just c divided by r. For this, c divided by r minus g let me rewrite this. 1 plus g divided by 1 plus r. To the power of n. Okay, in this term, this also. Now, you require some conditions here, right? For this term to go to 0, you need 1 plus g to be less than 1 plus r, right? Because you want the whole term, the parenthesis here, to be less than 1. Okay, so 1 plus g must be less than 1 plus r. So that's, you know, 1 doesn't matter. So it's really saying that growth rate must be less than r. And this condition is intuitive, right? So let me write this down for c divided by r minus g. Because first of all, mathematically, okay, if g is greater than r, then this whole term, okay, if g is greater than r, then this is negative. Okay, which doesn't make sense. You have a series, a positive number. Once you find the present value of that, how can it become negative? Okay, so that's the first aspect. The second aspect is more into a more economic. If growth rate is greater than discount rate, it means your money grows faster, okay, than your required rate of return. It can be like that in the short run, but if your money grows faster than the rate of return that you want, this is essentially a money pump. Okay, it's an infinite money generating machine where your benefit is always going to outrun what you expect from it. And it can't exist in principle because, you know, when you want to talk about perpetuity, this has to be true forever. It just breaks a logical step. So this mathematical restriction also becomes a logical restriction too. The growth rate of your cash flow better not be greater, okay, than the rate at which you're using to discount it. Okay, this ends the proof of the four basic formulae that we use as the building blocks for this class.